a great Indian tradition, great Hindu tradition, great tradition. We saw it practiced yesterday also in the Rath Yatra of ISKCON. We had joined them. And the tradition is, for all auspicious occasions, all Hindu auspicious occasions, they break coconut. And since we haven't broken, Bhagwan himself. What a wonderful thing. We've been doing yajna everywhere, and I have been doing yajnas for, I don't want to say, for many, 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 many years. And I have done Purna Huti and seen this thing done countless times, but our first time today, Bhagwan himself break that. Amazing thing. We are saying chapter 18 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita. And before we see the Gita every night, we see one name of Puja Gurudev. So today, last name is left. Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarupa. That is his name. When we used to go to school, one boy used to tell, when anytime you're asking his name, he used to say, and I remember it so well because that was funny to me at the time. You know? What is his name? John Tobias Botalamius Maka Davis. John Tobias Botalamius Maka Davis. That thing long, so. Yeah. So, anyway, we used to call him John for short. Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarupa. That is last name there. And also, it is a name that is common, that last name is common to many, many great saints and even avatars and all that. The last name of 108th name usually comes like that. Nitya Shuddha Buddha. So what is the meaning now? Nitya means eternally. Eternally, what? Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta. Shuddha means pure. Ever pure, the one taintless Brahman. Pure. Cannot be tainted also. Shuddha. Buddha. Buddha means eternally enlightened. Because Nitya goes with all of them. Eternally enlightened. And born enlightened. Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta, eternally free. Mukta, free. And why Mahatmas like that are born? Even though it's free. For us only. Why are they born? Out of compassion. You see the life of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa Vivekananji. They consciously decided, let us go. In some other loka. They were. Let us go. For who? For us. So even though they are mukta and eternally free, they come for our benefit. Yuga Purusha they are called. Once in a yuga. People like that come. So he was Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarup. His Nitya is like that. See, he was at no time bound. And then people ask, when did he get enlightenment? Well, that question is redundant, isn't it? When did he get enlightenment? Nitya Mukta. Nitya Buddha. Eternally he was. And we were very fortunate. We are very fortunate to be here to inherit his legacy. And we are with all of this wonderful and vibrant activities, put on by our, I must say, by our youth group. I want you to give them a big round of applause. This youth group has done a fantastic job. And And over the last few days, I have been listening very, very, very carefully to see if they would breathe a sigh of relief. But they look like they now start. You're ready to go, yes. No sigh of relief or anything. No? So they have done a fantastic job in really trying to bring to all the people of Trinidad and Tobago and Shaka Shakari. There are no people there, I think. But to bring to all the people of this nation this legacy which Gurudev has left. They have done a great job. Now, last night, some of the other acharyas were doing this. Now, what, 1854 finish? 55 finish? 1855 finish? Oh. Let us chant then from 1855, and then I'll introduce this whole. Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama,
Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama,
Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, Shri Krishna Sharanam.
Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama. वृंदावन बिहारी लाल की जय।
इन दिस ग्रेट ट्रेडिशन there has to be, the tradition teaches that there has to be an integration between head and heart, the two wings of the bird, which Gurudev talks about, which Bhagavad Gita talks about, the two wings of the bird that is required for the bird to soar into the heights of enlightenment. The head and the heart has to be integrated, have to be integrated. If they are not, a person going into spirituality with head alone, yeah, that dry and stone-like. And a person going into spirituality with heart alone, blind like a bat. There has to be a great integration. In these few verses which we are seeing here today now, Bhagavan is speaking about this integration between head and heart. This is the general theme which is happening there. The human being is born with no head. He's only born with heart. That also very restricted, because he only loves his own mother, own father, you know, siblings. Anybody else come there? You run quickly and hide there anymore. Have you seen? The heart is also very restricted, slightly developed only, but he loves, still he loves. But what about knowledge, knowing anything? He doesn't know. And after many years of teaching him also, he still doesn't know anything. One wife asking the husband, what is the date today? The husband said, I don't know. She said, but you're reading the newspaper in front of you there. He reading the newspaper, eh? He said, well, this wouldn't help. This is yesterday's newspaper. A simple calculation, you know. If this is yesterday's newspaper, and this is the date yesterday, then this has to be the date today. But he's still... Anyway. The heart has to be cultivated. And the head has to be educated. And when we say educated, we don't mean what you call as education here. This thing which you call as education here, that is guaranteed to destroy the person. That is called education today. It will make sure that you stay bound through the education system. So, when we say that the head has to be educated, we mean to say that head has to be educated. So you saw it in 16th chapter and all. Tasmat shastram pramanam te karya karya vyavasthitau. The shastra should be our guide in what has to be done and what ought not to be done. The shastra vidimutsrijya. You cast out the shastra and you live, you know, according to his whims and fancies and all. Nasa siddhim avapnoti. He'll not achieve anything. He'll remain bound in this universe. In fact, he'll go down. So, the shastra becomes the tool for educating this intellect. The shastra also becomes the tool for culturing the heart. In both cases, they have to be done along the lines of the shastras. So now, see, Bhagavan says, see what, which you saw last night, bhaktya mam abhijanati yavan yashchasmi tattvataha tato mam tattvato jnatva. Through devotion, bhaktya, my third case is given, through the instrumentation of devotion, mam abhijanati, the devotee, the sadhak, the spiritual aspirant, the seeker, he comes to know me through devotion. Devotion is the path, but knowledge is the goal. See, devotion is the heart and knowledge is the head. Bhaktya, through devotion. He comes to what? Know me. And Bhagavan Bhashyakar very nicely deliberates. See, the shastras tell, knowing Bhagavan and being Bhagavan, they are one and same. It is not that you will remain here and Bhagwan will be there, so you know that Bhagwan. No. Knowing Bhagavan and being Bhagavan is one and same. So, he says, Bhaktyamam abhijanati. By this devotion, the person comes to know me. How? Yavan. Exactly how I am. Yes, chasmi tattvataha. In reality, the way I am and who I am. Yacha asmi. How I am, yavan, and who I am. Tattvataha. In reality, the person comes to know me. And by which, see, by bhakti, he comes to know. So, both have to be there. Devotion has to be there. But knowledge also has to be there. It means if he is pursuing his knowledge and doesn't have this devotion, he will not come to know the Lord. Tataha, mam tattataha, nyatva. Having known me, what happened? Vishate tadanantaram. He enters me. Immediately. Enters me, but he just realizes his oneness. See, Bhashakar says here, there's a nice thing, eh? Knowing Bhagwan and becoming Bhagwan, they are not two separate things. Knowing the Lord and becoming the Lord, you see, like we say, when you know this, like in our school, right? When you know this, and then you write the exam, and then they confer you the degree, then you become a graduate. So there's a process. But here, there is no process. Knowing Bhagwan and being Bhagwan, becoming Bhagwan, they are one and same. No process. Huh? Though in language, when you express things, language has its own, you know, shortcomings and deficiencies. So you have to express things in certain ways. Like, for example, we say light and heat, right? So in language, we can separate light from heat in language. But in a fire, can you separate light from heat? How you'll separate? Put light here and heat here. No. So the language is like that. It has certain capacities. Certain capacities doesn't have. It can't tell the two things one time. Like that. Anyway, so there are many deficiencies in language. Vishate tadanantaram, immediately, that immediacy is not the immediacy that which we know in terms of time. Immediacy is something different here. It means one act which is expressed in two ways, knowing and becoming. That is the idea. Sarvakarmani api sada kurvano madhyapashrayaha madprasadada vapnoti shashvatam padam avyayam. This person who does all his actions, now see, I was telling you, is about the heart and the head, bhakti and knowledge. Sarvakarmani api sada. No karma has come. Karma yoga has come back. How karma has come inside there? When we're talking all the time about just two wings, not third wing. You know, bird has three wings. Three wings. This karma, which is being spoken about here now, see how it is qualified. Sarva karmani api sada kurvano mad vyapashrayaha. That is a qualifying word. Mad vyapashrayaha means taking refuge in me, he does his karma. The person who takes refuge in me and does his karma. So taking refuge is bhakti yoga, karma yoga. Taking refuge is bhakti yoga. So taking refuge, having taken refuge in me, one who does his karma, this is where karma yoga becomes bhakti yoga. Please remember, for those of you who are not here, I better recap this thing in beginning and all. I told that this Bhagavad Gita is divided into three parts, which is karma yoga, bhakti yoga, and jnana yoga. Right? And you know, in these verses, Bhagavan is demonstrating very nicely that these are not three separate parts. This is all sequential. Means you start with karma yoga, you move into bhakti yoga, and then you move into jnana yoga. It's not three parallel parts like that. This is a sequence. And how karma yoga is supposed to mature into bhakti yoga. And through that bhakti now, he says, mam abhijanati, comes to know me. So it ends in jnana. So karma matures into bhakti, and bhakti allows him to know the Lord. Knowledge of the reality comes to him. So it's sequential thing, yeah? Not parallel things in Bhagavad Gita. Now, if you study Karma Yoga a little bit, you go back to when we were studying in the beginning, you will see that we say, we do the action, whichever action it is, and I dedicate it to Bhagwan. Ishwara Arpana Buddhi, we call it. We do the action and dedicate it to Bhagwan. So, in that thing, that dedication to Bhagwan, that is the rudiments of love for Bhagwan, isn't it? The rudiments of love for Bhagwan is right there, because I am dedicating this action to the Lord. Why you dedicate to the Lord if you don't love Him? Some people say, I will dedicate it to Bhagwan because I am afraid of Him. Well, that is not dedication. That is buying security. Isn't it? It's not dedicating. Yeah, blackmail it is. Yeah. So, in Karma Yoga, there is the seedlings of bhakti. And that Karma Yoga is supposed to mature now. See, first I'm doing, and I'm doing it for Bhagwan. Second, I am not doing it. Bhagwan is doing it through me. And third, see, first the Karma Yoga, then Bhakti Yoga, that Lord Himself is acting through me. Oh, what a wonderful Lord. He's making everything happen. I can raise my hand only because He's making it. Rise into the sky like this. So, first, I'm doing it and dedicating it to Him. I'm here, He's there. Second, He's acting through me. Third, they know me. He is acting. There's knowledge. So this path is sequential like this. We start where we are. We are all like that, no? We feel that we are doing every day. In fact, let me tell you something. Nobody even follows this Karma Yoga. I'm doing this for Bhagwan. Everybody go to work every morning, think that they're doing it for them? For themselves. On the path also, nobody enters. And that's why, you see, when you get in the car in the morning time, you're rushing and everybody come to you. Bump him off and you pull inside his little, you go around the shoulder there a little bit and watch him to see if any police come in. You dedicating all that to Bhagwan? Wait, have Bhagwan in any of that? Nothing. If I tell you, let me tell you something. If Bhagwan come there and he give you a bad drive, getting it too, you know. Yes. Now, the vast majority of humanity just works selfishly. So in the beginning they say, no. We work and we dedicate it to Bhagwan. That's where Karma Yoga starts, and that is supposed to mature and become, you know, the Lord Himself is acting through me. Bhakti Yoga ends there. If for bhakti, there must be Bhagwan and Bhakta. There must be a Bhakta and Bhagwan. Otherwise, where is Bhakti? So I must be there and Bhagwan must be there. But I must understand that it is that great, wonderful Lord with infinite power who is making everything in this world happen. That's what we saw last night. Well, sorry for all you who were not here, but last night we saw that. That is that great Lord who is making everything happen. Still there is me and there is Bhagwan. But in knowledge, there is no me and Bhagwan. In knowledge, there is only Bhagwan. Ekoham. There is one. Chidananda Rupa. Of the nature of Satchit Ananda. One reality. So, he says, Sarva karmani sada kurvano madhyapashraya. The person who takes refuge in me and does all his actions. Means to say that all his actions are being done with the understanding that it is the Lord who is acting through him. That is, this is the Karma Yoga maturing into Bhakti Yoga. What happens to that person? Mat prasadada vapnoti shashvatam padamavyayam. That person reaches a supreme eternal state. How? Bhagavan says, mat prasadat. This is a very nice word. Comes everywhere in Bhagavad Purana and everywhere. Mat prasadat means the Lord, by the Lord's grace. And this is a word which you have to study. Now let me tell you about Lord's grace. Our rudimentary understanding of the Lord's grace is, you see, whatever we experience in human life, we always feel that Bhagavan also acts in the same way. Somebody, I do not know, maybe Spinoza said that if men were cows, we would think that Bhagavan has horns. Because whatever we see about ourselves, we imagine that Bhagavan acts in the same way. That is what is the point he was trying to make. That the Lord acts like us. And therefore we write in our scriptures also, God is a jealous God. Human beings. You know, if Bhagavan were jealous, I would have certainly become an atheist. Because I don't want to believe in any such. In any such God. If God was revengeful and vindictive and waiting to strike people on their head with a thunderbolt, me, I want to pray to no such God. Or, better yet, I'd have waited for my own thunderbolt. Because that is a natural instinct, isn't it? When you attack any animal, then what happens? No. We imagine all of these things. We write it also. And vast majority of human beings like sheep only. You know sheep? Bear. Oh. In Sesame Street, you see. One sheep is coming. And there's a cliff. And a whole line of sheep following this fellow. He goes. And there's a cliff here. Bear. Oh. The next one doesn't have sense enough to know. Look, bechara to mar gaya. Jo aage hai, aage wale, mar gaya. I have to stop. He doesn't, the first one goes, bae, oa. Second one, bae, oa. And the vast majority of humanity is like this only. So, he said, no. You have to apply this intellect and think. So this whole thing culminates in knowledge. You see here, culminates in which we just saw, culminates in knowledge. And then the whole thing happens now by Bhagwan's grace. And I started this topic by trying to tell you that Bhagwan's grace is not disseminated. Bhagwan's grace is not administered. Bhagwan's grace is not sold. Bhagwan's grace is not to be given as a favor. That I do this for you and you will do this for me. What a gross misunderstanding of the infinite grace of the Lord. If something is infinite, so Bhagwan's grace will be finite or infinite? It has to be infinite, no? Akhir mein toh Bhagwan hai. In final analysis, it's Bhagwan only. But his grace cannot be finite. If his grace is infinite, where is there question of ever showering something which is all pervasive and infinite? You could bring space from anywhere. Space is all pervasive, right? You bring some space here. Something that is infinite cannot go from one place to another. Where is there any question of Bhagavan ever showering grace? His grace is all pervasive, eternal, infinite, here, there, and everywhere, and there is no need to move him to shower any grace. And his nature is grace, and he is all pervasive. It means to say, his grace is waiting for the taking. The sunlight is waiting to give you vitamin D, but you hold an umbrella. So then what? Is not the sunlight fault? I mean, that's not Surya Bhagwan's fault. You hold an umbrella, you block him off. So the grace of God is like that. Ever present. Ever present. Waiting for the taking. And when the person opens up the doors of his intellect through proper knowledge, proper gyan, that is grace. Pause, and when you open your window, what happens to the sunlight? Pausing. So, mat prasadada vapnoti, by the grace of God, he says, by my grace, the person achieves the highest. But not that Bhagavan was waiting to shower the grace, that you were not opening your intellect, not opening your heart, not integrating the personality and opening up, you see. And he doesn't have to say, okay, now you open, okay, wait, come here. Take the grace. No such thing. That's why I told you just now, there are not two acts. The opening up of the heart, mind and intellect. This is why in our Sanskrit language, let me tell you, I'm saying intellect at one point, and I'm saying heart at the other point. You notice that? Because in our Sanskrit language, there is one, and that will come up just now. Hrit. Hrit in Sanskrit. So sometimes it is given as guha. Gufa. All sorts of words like that. That is the center of our being, where the head and heart meet. In English, you have to say head and heart and all that kind of thing. But when we say hriddeshe junatishtati, Bhagavan will tell you just now. I'm there, the core of your being. There, we block off the Lord's grace, block off the Lord's knowledge, enlightenment, everything is ananda. So the opening, is when you open your window, you don't have to wait for a moment for the light to come. If you know, you open a little bit, little light peeping. You open more light. Yeah, and there's no time gap between the two, isn't it? The opening and the coming in of the light, they're simultaneous events. In the very same way, the opening of our heart and the dawning of enlightenment, they're one and same. This is what is happening here. So, and that is that happens by the grace of the Lord. Means the Bhagavan's grace is waiting for that. It's just sitting there waiting. Take sunlight. Chetasa sarva karmani mai sanyasya mat paraha. Holding me to be supreme. You give up all sense of doership. You are doing anything in this world. Chetasa sarva karmani. That's why chetasa is given. By understanding. You come to understand. And we saw that in all the previous chapters and all. We are really not doing. And from third chapter, he's telling this thing. It is Bhagwan through his prakriti who is doing. Prakriti he kriyamana ani gunai karmani sarvashah. Ahankara vimurātmā kartā hamiti manyate. It is my prakriti who is doing everything. So you give up chetasa sarva karmani mai sanyasya. Having renounced all karmas to me, means to say, you don't have the feeling of doership. I did this, I am doing that, I am responsible, and you feel you're so important and so great and all that kind of thing. Just remember that Bhagwan is the one who is doing everything in this world through his prakriti, his own power, his own shakti, prakriti shakti. Holding him to be supreme, mat paraha, supreme lord of this universe, the controller of all things. Buddhi yoga mupashritya mat chitta satasam bhava. You take recourse to this buddhi yoga, means it's understanding. Simple thing. Take recourse to this understanding. Buddhi yoga, buddhi means intellect. Take recourse to this understanding and mat chitta satasam bhava. Means be absorbed in thinking about me as the supreme lord and the doer of all things at all times. Be absorbed in that thought. That is the idea. Machitta sarvadurgani mat prasadat tarishyasi. If like that I am able to keep my mind in Bhagwan all the time and understand he is doing everything, then sarvadurgani, he says, mat prasadat tarishyasi. We'll cross over all. Durgani means, you know, Durga name or Durga Maya. Name is what? Difficulty. So she who removes difficulty is called as Durga also. So here Durgani is plural. All difficulties, all afflictions, all trials and tribulations, sorrows, misery, affliction, all things that you go through in life which you don't like. By Bhagavan's grace, we'll cross over all of it. What it really means, Sarva Durgani means Sarva Samsar. We'll cross over all of Samsar. Because as long as you're in this Samsar, you will have difficulties or not. Let me tell you something. You will have from the day you are born till the day you die. Some people after they're gone too. Some after they gone, still trouble. Like I told you now, nowadays in some cemeteries in the world, they're not selling space like this anymore. Because the cemetery is full. You're selling, you have to put this coffin like this. You know, long ago they put the coffin like this. Now they put the coffin like that. So it's a hand that fella can't rest in peace. He had to stand up now. People are right now. R.I.P. R.I.P. Yeah. He had to put the S.I.P. now. S.I.P. yeah. Stand in peace. So, there will be difficulty, there will be sorrows, and there will be misery all the way past, we say, some past the grave also, but just we just speak like that only. Of course, when he gone, you know, nothing again, right? So, Sarva Durgani, Tarishyasi, you will cross over all of these difficulties. Atha Chetam Hankarat Nashroshyasi. And Bhagavan gives a warning here now. My dear Arjuna, he's speaking to Arjuna. My dear Arjuna, if you don't listen to me, you see where it comes from? It comes from Gita only. We just say that, everybody say that in the house. If you don't listen to me, you're in real trouble, you know. Direct from Gita. Yes. Nashroshyasi means if you will not listen, Vinangshyasi, you will get destroyed. You mean you in real trouble? And the word prior to that is the most important word. Please see this word. All human beings get into trouble only because of this word which Bhagavan uses here. You see, because Vinangshasi means you'll get destroyed. Means you'll get one trouble after the next, and it's all downhill, downward spiral. And eventually, ant mein, mar jayega. The Vinangshasi, destroyed. Like he gave in second chapter. And it is because of this one thing which is there in the third part of this verse. What is the third part? Yet, ahankarat nashoshyati. Why do people not listen? Why do people not do what is right? Why do people do all foolish things? Why do people get in trouble? Ahankarat. In 50s. Ahankar. That is the problem. And Arjuna heading down that road. Bhagavan say, he put up his hand. If you listen in Trinidad language, crapo smoke your pipe. When these foreigners came to Trinidad, these chicks and all them teach them this thing. Crapo smoke your pipe. Them foreigners, they don't even know what is a crapo. I reach Chicago. I hear one chick saying, crapo, smoke your pipe. Where you learn that from? Them trained that chick teach me that. And they remember it too. Anyway, so this, now see the word, Yad Ahankarat is given a fifth case. Ahankarat means, I told you a little bit of Sanskrit. You have to learn it, it's your language. The language of the gods, it is Deva Bhasha, it is called. And this is your inheritance. It belongs to you. Why don't you claim your inheritance? When you want to say, in English, right? Due to the rain. Due to the, and then rain. Means because of the rain. Right? Something happened. He fell, let us say. So that due to the, they're called prepositions in English. In Sanskrit language, we don't have such prepositions. So if you want to say due to the rain now, and you have no preposition, where you go say? So you just have to take the word rain and put it in the what is called a fifth case in Sanskrit. So it will be rainat. Fifth case will be rainat. Due to the rain. And if you have to say on the rain, you have to say rene. Like that. Like you just have to make some inflection of the word itself. Yes. There's nothing to add in beginning there. When you make some inflection in the word itself, then you get the sense. So, ahankara is the word, but here Bhagavan puts it in the fifth case. Ahankarat. Like Renat. Ahankara means due to ahankara. Got it? Because of ahankara. So why Arjuna doesn't want to fight? Why given Bhagavan all his attitude? Due to ahankara. Now what is Bhagavan's word? If you continue like this, if you continue like this and you persist with this ahankar, vinankshyasti, you will get destroyed. You're in real trouble. He said, and now see, further he tells. And all of these things come together so nicely in this Bhagavad Gita, I tell you. Mithya eshaha vyavasayaste prakritistvam niyokshati. In beginning, if you put in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita, we saw there in second chapter and all, first and second chapter, it visrijya sasharam japam shokasam vignamanasaha nashayotsyami iti govinda tushnim babhuvacha. Bhagavan, right there. He put down, I'll not fight. Arjuna. Nashayotsyami. Listen to Bhagavan's word. No. This is there, beginning. No, this is end. See Bhagavan's word. Mithya esha vyavasayaste. This deluded determination which you have made that you will not fight. It springs from mithya. Mithya means delusion. Mithya means false understanding, wrong understanding. This mithya, which caused you to make this determination that you will not fight, see Bhagavan's word. Prakriti stvam niyokshati. Prakriti will make you fight. You think you is the boss? This is the ahankar. Because I think I am the boss. Everybody thinks he is the boss. Let me tell you something now. The man who knows nothing of Shastras also. He feels he is the boss. He will tell you, why are you reading that stupid thing? He feels all of you stupid and he knows. He doesn't know one line of what is there. That is called ahankar. That ahankar pops up in so many wonderful ways. But one good thing about it, all Bhagavan Leela only. We can't say, see, if that fellow tells me, he's a fool. What are you reading a stupid thing for? If he tells me like that, right? And I say, you're a bigger fool. Then, that means he telling me with ahankar. But if I reply like that, that means I also have ahankar. Isn't it? So, when he tells me, I'm stupid, I do this, I do, I have to say, dekhe. Look how Bhagavan's Leela manifests like this. This fellow tells me I'm a fool. And when I'm going to write on the road, that fellow tells me you're real nice. So this one tells me I'm a fool. That one tells me I'm real nice. So I just now marvel at Bhagavan's Leela. Look. Kya baat hai. Bhagavan's Leela is wonderful. That is why he's telling in this Bhagavad Gita, sukha dukhe samaye kritva labha labhau jaya Jayo, you keep your balance. Because some will tell you, yeah, you're a fool. And then some will tell you, you're so nice. Huh? Yesterday I met a man in Portsmouth. He told me, Swamiji, man, nobody can touch you, you know. And I, where I do, you know, I said, boy, he tell me that in this is. Now I'm waiting for the next one. Because I won't get the next one soon. The next one will come because Bhagavan's Maya is made up of this dwandwa, isn't it? From beginning of Gita, we telling that. This Maya, this samsara is made up of dvandva. So if you hear this one, then tomorrow you'll get the next one. So to marvel at the Lord's Leela like that. Anything other than that is abhiman, ahankar. The moment we step out of that, ahankar comes in there. So we just have to marvel what to do. Ahankarat. Nashoshyasi. Vinanshyasi. You'll get this ahankar takes us down the path of destruction. So, Arjuna, you are heading down that path, you know. You think out of your ahankar, you know, you this, you that, and you say, you wouldn't fight. But you are no. See the next verse.
Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama. Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama.
Man, in all his ignorance, he thinks that he's in control of things. You know, today only I was looking at a video on YouTube, and it was a video on cosmology and the universe in which we live and all that kind of thing. If you try to find this earth in this vast, limitless universe, the earth itself doesn't fit here. Because their estimate, these scientists and all, I don't know why they don't buy Upanishad. They're estimating trillions of stars, and trillions of, you know, of planets and galaxies, and they're estimating. They're going on saying estimating. Are they buy Upanishad for $2, boy? You're going to find out that it's not trillions, it is infinite in number. But their numbers also are great big numbers also. Trillions and trillions of planets. Huh? And where does Earth fit in that? Nowhere! I mean, our Earth doesn't fit here. How do you think you fit here? That is a human! Let me tell you something. Forget trillions of stars. On this Earth, where do you fit here? You come in to listen to Swami Prakashananda here, isn't it? If I walk down right here in Trinidad and in Port of Spain, nobody will know me. What to talk about? Zero, if it is zero. But still my ego. This is what is happening to Arjuna there. And he feels he is in control. He is the master, he is the boss. Bhagavan is telling him, Swabhava jena kaunteya, nibaddha svena karmana. By your the nature which I have infused in you, that nature will push you. You have no choice in this matter. How do you think you have choice in it? Well, you created nature or what? Kartum naichasi. You don't want to do. Yan moha caused by your delusions. Karishyasyamasho pitat. Forcefully you will do. That's not in your hands. Who is controlling this universe? The one who doesn't fit here, he thinks he's so great. Bhagavan says, you will do by Prakriti. And who is the master of Prakriti? Last night we saw that. Prakriti is what? The Shakti of Bhagavan. Yan mohat is incorporated. See, previous verse, ahankarat. Due to ahankar. And here, mohat, again fifth case. Due to? Moha in this verse. The ahankar which is there, now this is one step deeper. The ahankar is called by moha. Delusion. Because I feel that I am separate from God, I am a master. What are masters of the universe? It's all such thing people say, na? Masters of the universe, some movie and all. We are masters of the universe, we are this, we are that, we are the other thing. But true spirituality really ends in the effacing of this ego. Totally. In favor of an infinite Lord with infinite power. Weaving his magic across the universe. Incomprehensible to us. But the effacing of the ego which makes us feel that we feet here and we are so great. He says, my dear Arjuna, Ishwara Sarva Bhutana, I am there, Ishwara, in the hearts of all Hriddeshe, at the core of all beings, O Arjuna, Tishtati, means I am there. I'm existing there. Then what do I do? Brahmayan Sarva Bhutani Yantrarurani Maya. By my Prakriti, Maya. Prakriti and Maya, Pradhan and all of these are one and by my Prakriti, I am making all things turn like machines. This verse is a very, very, very controversial verse. Because it doesn't jive with the ordinary man's experience. Because the ordinary man's because moha, he's in moha, right? He's deluded. He thinks, I am the boss, I am doing this, I am doing that, I am have my own power. And people guarantee their rights and freedom. Fundamental rights and freedoms based only in moha, delusion. It has, I'm just guaranteed by the constitution, and I'll take you to court if you violate my right. This raises a very deep question, which I have addressed many times during this yajna also, during this 108 nights, and at other places, and many places. I don't know if anybody has got it on, if it is there on YouTube, you might find it also. That is about whether everything is controlled by Bhagwan, they call it prarabdha, or whether we have purusharth, freedom to act. Whether there's freedom to act or whether everything is controlled by the Lord himself. Well, the short answer for that, I can only tell you short answer tonight. I told you long answer before. During this yajna only, at some venue. The short answer is, when you are in a state of ignorance, as we are, that time, yes, you have freedom to act. But when you in a state, when you are in a state of enlightenment and knowledge, then you realize, no, we don't have freedom. How can both be there at the same time? Both are there at the same time. Because the nature of the universe is like that. How? See, if I write here on my hand, right? Number six. When I look at it, it's six. If I show it to you, what you will see? How one thing could be two things? Possible or not? Yes. The world is like that. One thing could be two things. I'm tall or short? It depends on who is standing is a desire, isn't it? When I stand in front of my mother, I'm really tall. When I stand in front of गुरुदेव। I short. So now I tall or short? Both. Everything in the world is like that. So you have freedom to act or Bhagwan is control? Both. That is the nature of the universe. See? So in your ignorance, see, when a tiger chasing you in your dream, what are you going to do? Nah, come eat me. You tell the tiger like that? Come eat me. No. When the tiger chase you, run. Yes. So that time, you're running and you're sleeping too. Correct or not? If one, you see, people, you know, people are walking, they sleep. Yeah, some people are sleepwalking. They walk in their sleep. One man, he does jog in his sleep. He does get rest and exercise at the same time. But this is a wonderful thing. Anyway, all of this is to tell you that you have your education system, which has been really hammered into your head, which is such a false education system. It teaches you exclusivity. Meaning to say, one thing cannot be present if the other thing is present. You understand this? But the universe is not structured like that. While there is nighttime here, there is daytime somewhere else. So night and day present at the same time or not? The very structure of the universe is like that. And so, what you think is exclusive, then it is not exclusive. But your education system has drummed this into your head, the idea of exclusivity. Therefore, and that is taught through religion, through the whole system, all sorts of ways. We are right, you are wrong. That's what it taught to you. We say, no. Why? See, I see six, I am right. When you see nine, you are right or not? You're right. So this thing has to be understood. Then this idea will make sense. What? There is the hand of Bhagwan making everything happen, and there is a freedom of choice. Both are the same time. When knowledge dawns, this thing will become more and more clear. That's why you have to go on. You don't understand Shastra in a day. That's why we have 2-year course, not 2-day course. You come and you study there. So, he says, I am there in the heart of everybody, making, that is from the highest standpoint, making everything happen. When we are at the lowest standpoint, where we are, we think we are making everything happen. Tameva sharanam gachas svabhavena bharata sarvabhavena bharata tat prasadat param shantim sthanam prapsasi shashvatam. You take refuge, my dear Arjuna, give up this ego. Antameva sharanam gacha. You take refuge in the supreme reality. Because right now you are taking refuge in ego. And take refuge in the supreme reality. What will happen? By the grace of the supreme reality, shantim sthanam prapsyasi shashvatam param shantim sthanam. You will reach the supreme state of peace. So in the Trod Gita, I told you, peace, enlightenment, realization, sukham, ananda, all of these mean one and same. Param shantim, just give the param there as adjective. Param shantim, supreme peace. Because people have a little bit of peace now and then. Some peace, there's a peace. We have a little piece of peace. Sometimes. When you get something where you like, when you get like ice cream and cake and you sit down in one corner by yourself and nobody has seen you. You get a little piece and thing. You get a piece of cake too. Anyway. Now, the next verse is one of my most favorite verse in this chapter. One of. Which of my other favorite verses? The rest. It's one of my most favorite verse. Why? Because it truly characterizes Hinduism. It truly tells the character of this great and ancient religion to which you belong. See this verse.
Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama. Shri Krishna Sharanam.
Jnanam akhyatam means this knowledge which has been imparted by me to you. Akhyatam means said, taught, given, imparted. Iti te means to you. Jnanam akhyatam, this knowledge which has been imparted by me to you. Guhyat guhyataram maya, by me, and which is of the nature of supreme secret. This knowledge is a supreme secret. Supreme secret means this knowledge is not something that comes by just like that. It's rare thing. Not known by so many. He says, my dear Arjuna, vimrishya etat asheshena, means you examine this knowledge, analyze it, take it apart, reflect on it, contemplate on it, whichever knowledge I have imparted. Take it apart, one by one, word by word, syllable by syllable, study it, analyze it. And Bhagavan tells the most wonderful thing in that last part, yatha icchasi tatha kuru, as is your wish, you do. There is no shastra in the world, which guarantees the individual the freedom like this. Even Bhagwan doesn't want him to. Bhagwan also doesn't say, you do as I tell you to do, or else. Bhagwan just tells, there is this part and there is this part. If you go down this part, your dog dead. If you, and not because I go do it, because that is the part entails that. You understand? That's like any thing in life, right? If you want to get some food to eat, there are certain places you go. Certain places you don't go. Because that going there entails something that is going to be detrimental. So there is this path and there is this path. If you go down this path, you'll get in real trouble. That's why I was just telling you. Because out of your ahankar, you say, nah, where he know? Where I want? I go do as I? Please, and you go down that path, well, you'll get in trouble. But if you go down this path, you see? Tameva sharanam gacha. Take refuge in that absolute reality. He says, that person will certainly, param shantim nigacchati, he'll reach the supreme state. So this is the other part. So right here, Bhagavan is telling you two parts. But he said, in the final analysis, yatha icchasi tatha kuru, the choice remains in your hands. In Hinduism, there is never the taking away of anybody's choice from their hands. They have the final say. Do you know, in the most important things in Hinduism, we have the final choice, even in the choice of a guru. See, for any person who is born in this world, his guide and mentor, is that guru. And in that, the person still has his own freedom of choice. Hinduism doesn't want to take away anybody. So Bhagwan also, therefore we say, there are no commandments in Hinduism. We tell you, this part and this part, you say, a big man thing now happen. That's what we mean to say. We're talking to mature people. I mean, preserving your right and your freedom and all that. This is the only place where your right and freedom is protected. You're trying to write constitution and all that kind of thing. Gita also is protecting it. In other words, I'm then said, Vimrishaitana Sheshena means you reflect, analyze. Whatever I have said, if it makes sense, you follow. It doesn't make sense, you cast it out. It may not make sense to you today, it may make next week. But if it doesn't make sense right now, then. One more point, and I'll close here tonight. Let me tell you about this. If this is a religion that teaches freedom, if this is a religion that teaches mukti, absolute freedom, how can this religion ever bind you to my point of view? How can I say this is the point, and you, if you don't follow it, you're damned. We teach it about freedom. That is what the whole religion is based on. Eh? Mukti, moksha. So we're going free right here. You're free to do as you please. Just know that if you make this choice, this is the consequences. If you make this choice, this is it. These are the consequences. That is all. So it treats every human being as a mature human being. With self-respect and dignity. And treat you like a child. Put on your uniform. Take up your bag. Oh, eat your breakfast first. Take up your bag. Put on your shoes. Tie your lace. Now get to school. You command children, isn't it? That's commandment or not? You command children. You try that with your spouse now. When you come back, you're going to have no house, no spouse, no nothing, isn't it? So, with a mature person, you tell them, my dear, here is one path. These are the consequences. Here is the other path. These are the consequences. You make your choice. This is Hinduism. The verse concludes. Now the next verse, Bhagavan says, my dear Arjuna, I hope you listen to all this, you know. But if you didn't listen, I'm going to summarize the whole thing for you again. Who is Shrenu? You listen again. But Bhagwan's words are very nice. You know, there are some people when they say, I'm going to tell you that again. Well, no, you want to. Again? No. But Bhagwan's words are very nice. He'll tell again, and this also shows compassion of the Lord. He'll go all out of his way to say the same thing. You know, we lose patience, you know. Boy, how much time I tell you that? We lost patience a long time. And one man said, I tell you a million times you should not exaggerate. But the Lord goes on repeating because he knows, and out of compassion, but no, never getting impatient or anything. So he'll repeat, but he'll repeat tomorrow.